Hello everyone, welcome back to a new video. In this video, we are going to make a grid-based racing game. So let's see how that looks.
Okay, so we have this game called the Grid Race. In this, the green square is the player, us actually, and the red one is the opponent. The objective of the complete race is to get to this yellow square as soon as possible. We will try our best to reach the yellow box before the opponent, the red box, reaches it. And the opponent will also try to reach before the green box approaches. So this is a turn-based game. Both the players will get turns to choose their actions. The actions can be right, down, left, or up. These are all the rules of the game. Let's play some iterations of the game to see the AI opponent algorithm in action. In this game, we reach the yellow box first, so we win the game. Let's try another one. This game, the opponent or the computer reached the yellow box first, so it wins the game. Now let's try this again one last time. And in this final game, we won the game because we reached the yellow box first.
Okay, so the opponent that you saw in the red color was following an algorithm, a path planning algorithm called Dijkstra's algorithm. So let's see how that works. Now, in order to understand Dijkstra's algorithm, let us first discuss what is in effect a path planning algorithm and how does it work. As the name suggests, a path planning algorithm takes two parameters, which are the start location and the end location, and then it returns us a path from starting to the end location. Now, whilst planning or solving for a path from the start to the end, it has an objective to maximize or minimize. Now, the objective can be anything. It can be the path should take the least amount of time, or the path should cover the least distance, or even the path should have a velocity that is constrained under some values. Usually, and for our case as well, we are using the shortest path planning. That is, the objective is to plan a path that is the shortest from start to the end. Alright, so now let's discuss how path planning actually works. Okay, so path planning algorithms usually work on graph data structures. Now, graph data structures are discussed in one of my previous videos. I'll put a link to the description for that. But we will briefly go over what a graph is. So, for the path planning perspective, a graph, we can say, is a set of waypoints that are connected. For instance, the nodes that we can see over here, these are the waypoints that any player can be in. And the edges that are present between the nodes represent that we can go from this waypoint to this waypoint to this waypoint, and this waypoint to this waypoint. So this graph depicts what are the different waypoints and how we can actually reach them. Alright, now let's discuss how the path planning algorithm actually works. So we are given two nodes, which are the start and the end. So the first thing that we have to do is define a function f of x, where x is a node in this graph. Now, f of x is going to decide a score for that particular node. For the start node, we assume that the function is going to equal a value of 0. So, f of 0 is equal to 0. Now, starting at the start node, we are going to expand the graph and see what are the other waypoints or the nodes that are connected to it. So, we can see in this case, we have three nodes that are connected to the start node. And then, we calculate the same function f of x for these three new nodes. Now, for instance, we can assume that these are f of 1 is equal to 1, f of 2 is equal to 2, and f of 3 is equal to 3. Once we have calculated f of x for the neighboring nodes, then we need to decide how we want to optimize over f. Do we want to select the maximum value f? Do we want to select the minimum value of f? Or we want to select an average or a middle value between them? Usually for path planning, f of x is taken such that we need always to take the minimum value of f of x. So in the next step, we do the same thing. We take f of 1 equals 1, we take this node, the minimum 1, and we expand it further. So we have these two nodes that are branching out of this first node. and their function values are also computed, which we are again assuming to be f of 4 is equal to 4 and f of 5 is equal to 5. Alright, so now with all these expanded nodes, which are the 4th node, 5th node, 2nd node and 3rd node, we again select a minimum value of f. In this case, we have f of 2 is equal to 2, which is the minimum value of f. So we select this 2nd node and expand it again. And on expansion, we can see that we have a single node we have over here, and the node is 6 and f of 6 is equal to 6. Now in the next step, we are again going to choose a minimum value of f from all these nodes that we have, which is going to be f of 3, and then we're going to expand it. Like this, we are going to keep expanding the nodes one by one by selecting the minimum f value. Once we reach the end node, we are going to terminate the algorithm. And this is how any general path planning algorithm works. Now, implementation wise, when we write the computer code, there is some slight difference, but the overall thing or the idea remains the same. So, in order to convert a general path planning algorithm into the Dijkstra's path planning algorithm, all we have to do is take the function f of x to be a distance from the start node. For instance, in this case, we can assume that the distance from the start node is just the sum of the edges. For instance, for this node, the distance from the start is 1 plus 1 is equal to 2. And the distance to start for this node or for all these three nodes can be 1, 1 and 1. So by setting f of x to be the distance from the start node, we get the Dijkstra's algorithm. Okay, cool. Now we understand the Dijkstra's algorithm. Now let's get into some more specific details about some things over here. Now, to apply Dijkstra's algorithm to the game that we saw, we need to convert the grid that we had into a graph. So how do we do that? So for a grid, we are going to assume that any cell we have over here are considered as the nodes of the graph. So any of these cells will be considered the nodes. And for any cell, we assume that its neighboring cells, the upward cell, the downward cell, the left cell and the right cell, all of these are connected by edges. So we can move from any cell to its neighboring one of the four cells. And the cost we are also assuming right now to be equal to 1. Now to make Dijkstra's algorithm behave in a certain way, for instance, we don't want the agent that we have take left turns. So we are going to assign this left edge a higher value compared to these three other values. This way Dijkstra will try its best not to take this left action. Also, if we are present in a cell that is located near an obstacle, then we either cancel the movement of the agent in that direction or we can assign a very high value of weight to that action. For instance, in this case, the upward is an obstacle, so we simply ignore the upward action or assign a very high weight to that upward action. Now, if the cell is present in a corner or it is present along the edge, then we also cancel out the movements that take it beyond the boundary of the game. So this is how we convert a grid into a graph. And now we can input this graph into the Dijkstra's algorithm and that algorithm can return us the path. Okay, so let's now discuss some of the optimizations that we can apply to the path planning algorithms. The most time consuming step of any path planning algorithms is to choose the next node. So if we have these four expanded nodes, the most amount of time our algorithm is going to take is to select the minimum from all of them. Now why is this? Because if we store all these values in a list type of format, then in order to find the minimum value, we need to check each and every element of that list. Now while we are checking, we are not using the knowledge that we have previously to us. For instance, in this case, we already know that f of 4, f of 5 and f of 3 are some values and f of 6 is a new value that is added. So when we are iterating over these values, we are checking these three values again. And this is where we are repeating ourselves and not doing the optimal thing that we should have been doing. Now, in order to calculate the minimum element from this list in the most optimal way, we use a data structure called a heap. In particular, we use a minimum heap. Now the topic of heap is something that will take another video to explain, but we will briefly go over it, what it is. Now a minimum heap is a binary tree that has the property that the nodes of the subtrees or the children trees of any node are going to be greater than the node itself. Let's discuss that using an example. For instance, at the parent node or the root node, we have 1. Now the condition says that all of its subtrees, all the nodes that are in its subtrees, should have a value that is greater than 1. And we can see that we are actually satisfying this condition. The subtree has values 5, 10, 20, 3, 6 and 2, which are all greater than 1. Now this property is actually recursive. For this node, we can see the parent value is equal to 5 and its children has values that are greater than 5, which are 10 and 20. Similarly, we can see that this holds for this right subtree as well. Now this data structure helps us to find the minimum element in a very fast way. To compute the minimum element, we simply need this parent node over here. Along with retrieving this minimum value, we also have two other functions that we need to take care of, which are adding new values to this heap. For instance, if when we expand new nodes, then we are going to get new values. We need to insert them into this minimum heap as well. Also, we need to remove the minimum element as well, so we can move on to the next steps of the algorithm. And a very good thing about heaps is that it does both of these operations in log of n time. So in a sense, when we were simply iterating over these nodes, we were taking a time that was roughly n, the number of nodes that we have currently. But when we use a heap, we reduce that time to log of n. This is a very significant reduction of time if we speak in terms of computer science. Alright, so this is the complete picture of the AI algorithm that was being used in the grid racing game. Now let's get into some of the implementation details of the algorithm. So let's do this.
So the way we have implemented this is we have a class by the name of Dijkstra's algorithm, and it contains certain private and public variables and this function called plan. Now plan is the actual function that does the path planning for us. Okay, so the first thing that we do is initialize a minimum heap. And in order to do this, we have used a priority queue. Now a minimum heap is also called a priority queue. And this priority queue, we are using this from the C++ standard library. So what we are saving in this priority queue, it is the node variable. Now what is the node variable? Okay, so node is a self-defined data structure over here. First, we have a data structure pair int comma int, which we call pi. And that pi is used to initialize node. So what is node? A node is a pair of int comma a pair. Pair of int comma int. So what node actually stores, it stores the distance in the integer, in the first integer. And it stores the node in the second part of the pair. And these two parameters over here, these are used to initialize a minimum heap rather than a maximum heap. Then we initialize a matrix that contains the distances of different nodes or grid from the start point. Then we initialize a parent table. Now this table contains a parent of a particular node or a grid, as we can say. So if we have a grid over here, we also need to remember from the path where we came from. Now whether we came to this grid point from up, from left, from down, or from the right, we need to remember all these parents so we can finally get a path which the opponent can follow. Then we insert our source node into the priority queue or the minimum heap. And then we start the search. And we will keep on doing this until the minimum heap has been emptied. So we get the minimum data from our minimum heap. That's why we are using it. So we can get the data as fast as possible. And then we insert the adjacent nodes, the left, down, right, and up neighbors into the minimum heap. So how we do that? For the left one, we are in the same row, but we go to the previous column. Now, if there exists a shorter path to the neighbor through the current node that we are sitting at right now, then we will update the weight of that node accordingly. So here we are doing that. We're checking the adjacent cost is greater than the current cost plus 1. And if it is, and there are no obstacles over here, then we update the distance table and push that to the minimum heap. We also update the parent as well, so we know where we are transitioning all along. We do a similar thing with the right one, where we are adding another column. We are going to the next column. We do this thing similarly for the up neighbor, and we do this thing similarly for the down neighbor. And then once we are done with the minimum heap loop, then we finally return the restore path function that takes in the parent table. Now let's see what this restore path function contains. So here we have the restore path. Now it is a vector of a pair of int comma int, which we call the path. So we are initializing it over here. Now we initialize a current point variable with the final position that we have, the goal position. And then we keep iterating until we get to the node that we are starting on. Like this, like the current point dot first is not equal to start position, and the current point dot second is not equal to start position one. So until this condition is satisfied, we keep on pushing the current point to the path and updating the current node to equal its parent. So we are going backwards in time. Finally, we reverse the vector path, which we have done over here, and then we finally return the path. So this is the overall code of the Dijkstra AI algorithm. Okay, so now let's discuss the game in a more logical point of way or a computer science way rather than a more AI one. So let's do this.
Okay, so now let's discuss this game from a more logical point of view. Now, in order to reach this target over here, and if we are starting from this point, the most optimal, or we can say the shortest way, is going to be by only taking the right direction and the down direction. Because the optimal path is going to consist of some combination of this right and down actions. Now, for instance, if we start from here and we have these four obstacles over here, then the optimal paths can be, we start from here, down, down, right, down, right, 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 and till there. Similarly, we can also have another optimal path that goes right at the start, down, and then right. All these paths contain the same number of actions, but the combination of how these actions are actually taken is different. So this leads us to, so for both of these players that are starting from the corners, the optimal path is going to be of the same length, but the combination is going to be different. So using this information, we can derive three conclusions. The first conclusion is that the start position influences how the player is going to perform. If another player starts from here, then its optimal path length is going to be shorter than the players that have started from here or from here. That way, it has an increased chance of winning. The second conclusion is that the obstacles in this game were randomly generated. So these obstacles that we can see over here, these are random generations. So if the obstacles are generated in such a way that one of the player has to take one non-optimal action, for instance, for this player, an upward or leftward action, then this player has a higher chance of losing compared to this one. Third conclusion is, since both of the players have their optimal path of the same length, which player is going to finally win depends on the turn that they have. From these two players, the player that gets the first turn is always going to win. All in all, we can conclude that winning at this game depends more on luck, how the obstacles are placed, and who gets to take the turns first, rather than the skill. Now, I included this discussion because it was interesting to note the logical facts behind this game as well. Alright, so this is it for this video. If you like the video, please press the like button and subscribe to the channel for more such videos. See you in the next one. Bye.